Friends, again, let's come in the presence of God, and especially we will come to the scripture. We'll read a passage that's in the New Testament, and it's a book, and Philemon. In fact, this book has only one chapter, and even Jude has only one chapter, and 2 John and 3 John, all these books do have only one chapter. So here in the book of Philemon, we see Paul speaks to Philemon. An appeal to him for Onesimus. In fact, when he was writing this epistle to Philemon, he was in the prison. Verse 1 says, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in the house. So, when Paul was in prison, something happened. Even in the prison, he was sharing gospel with people, even to the fellow prisoners. And sometimes that happens in history. Sometimes some people are imprisoned and they share gospel with their fellow prisoners, and they also accept Jesus. Now when Paul was in the prison, he was sharing gospel with a man called Onesimus. And Onesimus, he was a prisoner and he was a slave. He was not a free man, he was a slave. We do not know what happened to him. Maybe in those days, if a slave is running away, naturally, he will be caught and he will be in the prison. So that can happen. So Onesimus, he was a slave of Philemon, and in the prison, when Paul shared gospel with this slave, he accepted Jesus. And you know what happened? He started serving Paul. And maybe his days of imprisonment is over, so it is time for him to be free. But you know, he was serving Paul even after his imprisonment. And Paul is writing a letter on behalf of this Onesimus to Philemon. And it is said, verse 10, I appeal to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I have become in my imprisonment. So he is not calling Onesimus a brother in Christ, nothing like that. I'm a father. He's my son. Look, Onesimus is only a slave, but Paul considers him as his own son. And he says, I am sending him back to you, sending my very heart. When I am sending Onesimus to you, I am sending him to you because you are the owner of Onesimus. In fact, he was a slave, and who is the owner? Philemon. Philemon also was a very good believer, and that's the reason why we see when Paul was writing, Verse 4, I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of your faith which you have towards the Lord Jesus Christ and all the saints. So Philemon is a person who loves the Lord and also the saints. And it is heard by Paul. That means the love and concern of Philemon is appreciated by even people outside. And that must be the reason why Paul heard about his love in those days. And he says, and I pray that sharing of your faith may promote the knowledge of all the good that is ours in Jesus Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. It all speaks about Philemon. So Philemon was refreshing the hearts of many saints. That's a good quality. So we all should follow this thing, that we need to see that we are refreshing the hearts of the saints. And verse 8, accordingly, though I am bold enough to in Christ to command you to do what is required, yet for love's sake I prefer to appeal to you, I, Paul, an ambassador and now a prisoner also for Christ Jesus. Paul says, what I am asking you, even I can command you. Because it is through Paul, Philemon received all the spiritual things. So he has all the right to command Philemon. But now it is not a command, it is an appeal. You know why? Because it is about the slave of Philemon, now a believer. Not only a believer, Paul calls him my son, who is begotten in the prison. So he could easily ask or command Philemon, but he says that I do not want to see that it is by force I am taking his service. I appeal to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I was become in my imprisonment. Verse 12, I am sending him back to you, sending my very heart. I would have been glad to keep him with me in order that he might serve me on your behalf during my imprisonment for the gospel, but I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, but of your own free will. That is the only reason. He says, I can command you, but I want to see that it is not by force. I need the help or the service of Onesimus in this prison, but I'm not asking you or, you know, compelling you. But if you say, yes, you can have the service of Onesimus on my behalf, because in fact, Onesimus belongs to Philemon. Okay? So I'm thinking about the concern Paul had about, not about Philemon, about Onesimus. I told you, he's only a slave. And in those days, slaves were considered as just like things, you know, like animals, nothing more than that. But when he accepted Jesus, he considered him as son. And also he is very much concerned about his convert. So this gives us a real question to our dealings with people. We are all happy to have converts, but what is our attitude towards our converts? When they accept Jesus, we just Say, come on, brother, you can come and worship. That's all. And people are not just souls. They have a body. They have emotional needs, physical needs. They need everything, every kind of comfort. The problem with us, many times, we are considering them just as souls. Now, they have personality, they have social relationships. Paul, when in prison, became the spiritual father of Onesimus, and he said, he's my son. Look, when a person like Paul calls him son, emotionally, he might have been elated like anything, right? So just a word. But you know, that gives him all the cheer that is needed. Maybe some words that we speak, that's very important. How do we call people? Some kind of affectionate words. You know, sometimes we call everybody brother. Good. Calling brother is good. But you know, we are not meaning it. Even if I call somebody, say, brother, I tell you, calling brother, but you know, we are not considering him as a brother. When we call somebody son, he should be a son. Because every word you speak, if it is yes, it should be yes, and if it is no, it should be no. If you call a person son, he should be a son. If you call somebody brother, he should be a brother. If you call somebody sister, he should be a sister. So when Paul was talking or calling a person or speaking to a person, he really meant it. He was considering his converts as his children. Even for other people, Philemon, and also take the case of from Lydia onwards. Maybe that was the first convert in Europe. Even before that, he was in Asia Minor. And you know, he was keeping that relationship. He was not like the Pharisees. The Pharisees, even Jesus said, who struggled to see conversions, and then they forget the convert. And that is the reason why in Matthew chapter 23, verse 15, Jesus said, woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You travel over the land and sea to win a single convert. And when he becomes one, you make him twice as much a son of hell as you are. See? So first of all, we need to love people. I used to tell people that if you want to share gospel with somebody, first, you love them. Everything should be out of love. If you do not love a person, you have no right to share gospel with him. And when that person is accepting Jesus, it's an act of love. And then you need to love him as your own brother. So Christianity is not just giving a philosophy. It's not a philosophy. You are giving Jesus, and it is not only giving Jesus, even giving yourself. That's what we see. Paul says, I'm much concerned about Onesimus, and I want to see that he is coming back to you. And it is said that formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and to me. Formerly he was useless. Maybe I told you, we do not know, but it was quite possible that he left Philemon and he was a runaway slave. Maybe he was not useful to Philemon earlier. But now what we see, he is so useful. Useful for you and also to me. That means when somebody is converted, when somebody accepts Jesus, he is becoming a new creation. That is also there. When somebody accepts Jesus, he is becoming a new creation. Earlier we all were not useful for others, but now we are useful for others. We should be. So when you are converted, you are transformed. It is not just conversion, it is transformation. So this transformation happened to Onesimus. And Paul considered him as his own son. And again, we need to understand that this is really Christianity. And when you are a Christian, then you are much concerned about your brother. Not only about your converts, of course, we need to be more concerned about our converts, but even otherwise, you know, the love towards your brother. That's what makes you true Christian. That's the reason why even we read that love your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your brother as you love yourself. It's not just loving God. It's also loving your brother and sister. In the book of James chapter 2, when we read about faith, we see verse 8, it says, if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you do well. What does it mean? That is a royal law. What is a royal law? You shall love your neighbor as yourself. That's a royal law. Yeah, of course, we have all the laws and we need to obey the laws of God. We need to obey the Ten Commandments. Everything is there. But James calls it royal law. You need to love your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. That's there. But the second thing, it is loving your brother or love your neighbor as you love yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin. And you are convicted by the law as transgressors. So when you are not obeying the law, we need to understand, even though you are in New Testament, don't think that there is no law. Law is everywhere. Sometimes people think the law started at Mount Sinai. No. The law started in the Garden of Eden. Even in the Garden of Eden, there was law. So some people say, yeah, it was from Mount Sinai to Calvary, Mount Calvary. So that is the period of law. And now there is no law. No, there is law. And if you do not fulfill, that's if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. That's what we see here. And again, verse 14, James 14, what does it profit, my brother, if a man says he has faith but has not works? Can his faith save him? If a brother or sister is ill clad and lack of daily food, and one of you says to him, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what does it profit? So faith by itself, if it has no work, it is dead. We say that we have faith. Of course, faith is needed. But you know, faith by itself, if it has no works, it is dead. So we need to have faith, but we also need to have works. And that's what we see here. Paul was not preaching big things or all the doctrines, but if works do not follow my faith, it is dead. That's what we say. That's the reason why. Even in last verse, chapter 2, James, for as the body apart from spirit is dead, so faith apart from works is dead. As the body apart from spirit is dead, so faith apart from works is dead. So we need to see that we are practicing the faith. Paul was practicing the faith. He was always practicing the faith that he was preaching. Even when he was talking about the Thessalonians, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, when he speaks about the Thessalonian people, he said, verse 7, "But we were gentle among you, like a nurse taking care of her children," like a nursing mother. "So being affectionately desirous of you, we were ready to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you had become very dear to us." What does it mean? Paul says, we were not only preaching gospel to you, but you were so dear to us. So even we were ready to give our own selves. We were ready to die for you. Paul was ready to die for the Thessalonians. Paul was ready to give everything for the cause of Onesimus. And you know what he says? He says, if, verse 18, Philemon, if he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. That's what he says. If he has done any wrong or owes anything to you, charge it to me. That's what he says. I'm ready to pay back. I, Paul, write this with my own hands. I will repay it, verse 19. To say nothing of your owing me, even your own self. Okay. Maybe you own yourself to me. That's what he says to Philemon. But if Onesimus owes you anything, charge it to me. How many of you are, or we are, ready to say like that? That's when we love people. We are ready to spend for others. We are ready to, even Paul says, even we were ready to die for you. So sharing gospel is all good thing, but we need to understand that we need to live for what we believe, and we need to live for what we preach. Hallelujah. My friends, it is a time for retrospection. Look to ourselves. We are eager to share gospel with people, but are we ready to pay a cost for that? It is costly. Sometimes it is very costly. But Paul was ready to pay a cost. He said, if he owes anything to you, charge it to me. He is a prisoner now, but still he says, I will repay it. Paul himself was a prisoner. I tell you, this is love. We need to see that we are loving people. Only then we will be able to share gospel with people. May God bless you. Close your eyes. Lord, we are sharing gospel with others, but we doubt whether we love people like Paul loved Onesimus. And we want to consider people as our own children, our own brothers, our own sisters. It's not just in words, O God, but in reality. Yes, Lord, it is costly. Love is always costly, we know that. Even Lord, when you loved the world, you gave your only begotten Son. Like you gave your life for us, and we want to see that we are giving our lives for our brethren. And that's the thing that we need to do, O God. Help us to see that we are following you in everything, especially in loving others and living for others. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.